Hey guys, so we are going to start some fashion history. You should be in your Unit 2 packet on the first fashion history page. You've got a question up at the top that says, how often do trends repeat? Excuse me, it's every 20 to 30 years. And we're going to really see that throughout fashion history. So be looking for some trends that repeat every 20 to 30 years. So 1890s fashion. This is known as the Victorian era. The reason why is because it's named after Queen Victoria. The era actually ends in 1901, but we're really going to just talk about 1890 to 99. And the reason why it ended was because that was the year that Queen Victoria died. So I've got a little video. I'm going to post it on Canvas for you. I highly recommend that you pause this video and you go to that video right now so that you can see a little bit more about Victorian life. Okay, so you probably watched that video. You've got a little bit more insight. So we're going to go ahead and dive right in. So the hourglass silhouette. This was the silhouette that was very popular in the 1890s. I do want to stress that this was an exaggerated hourglass. It wasn't a natural hourglass, okay? It was very wide at the bottom and the top and then very, very narrow in the middle. Women, and you can really see it in these illustrations, women had very small waists. The way that they did that was by wearing some corsets and bustling. So they would actually break their ribs in order to have a narrower waist. It was a very, very different time than today. However, artists started sketching young women, okay? The artist that created this sketch, known as the Gibson Girl, was Charles Gibson. He published these sketches in newspapers, and this set a standard for the all-American girl. So at this point in time, we are now getting a standard for women to start to look like. The exaggerated hourglass was huge here. Like I said, shoulders were wide, waists were cinched by corsets, and the hip was incredibly increased by the bustle. So you can see here, we've got a little ad advertising this corset. So when I say that women really, really tried to get this narrow waist, they were using a corset every day and they had to have someone else put them in it. They could barely breathe. Women would pass out because they couldn't breathe. It was a very different time. So this is a picture of the corset naturally, okay? And then this is kind of what the corset looks like when you first put it on. It just kind of conforms to your body. And then when you cinch it in place, this is what happens. You can see that you're really pushing everything in and it's going to actually damage internal organs as well as break some ribs. The bustle. This was the type of framework that was used to create this full wide hip. And there were lots of different types of bustles. So the bustles that you might be able to buy today will probably be made out of fabric and lightweight items. The bustles that women wore were made out of metal. So not only could they barely breathe because they were in these awful corsets, but they also were carrying around extra pounds of weight just for that bustle, and not to mention the weight of their dress. Their dress had lots of layers and it was heavy to wear regardless. Now add some metal framework and a corset and it's just a recipe for disaster. So in 1890, around 1890, the bustle is going to start to disappear. So they're still using those corsets. They're still having lots of layers on their clothing, but the skirt is going to become very slim in the front and full behind without those poofs or lifts. And during this decade, the focus switched from the skirt to the bodice. So now the bodice has a lot of ruffles and beadwork on it. The skirt becomes a lot plainer and the bodice has lots of layers and frills. We're gonna look at some pictures here. So in 1993, this was what was known as an evening dress. You can see that it's not bustled. It doesn't have that super wide, but you still have that very narrow waist. Lots of frills, lots of ruffles, very, very busy up top, right? In both of these pictures. And then down here, it's a lot plainer. This was the day dress, okay? So you can see here, it has nothing on the top of this one. It's a lot plainer, and so is the bottom of the dress. So you can see that women, if they were gonna go out dancing, they had a very different look to them as to when they were just doing stuff around the town on the day, okay? So now, in 1894, something really great happened. The tailor-made suit occurred. And this suit was very plain, usually with jacket bodices. What this means is that we can now have different outfits, sort of. Like, I say sort of because now they can switch the jackets out with the different dresses. We don't have separates yet. These are still dresses, but now they can switch their jackets out and they can have a different appearance. Accessories were very, very, very big in this era. Women wore fans, jewelry, gloves, and of course shoes. So fans were used to cool off after dancing, but this was the major tool for flirting for women. It wasn't proper to be very forward as a woman when it comes to flirting. So they would use fans to hide their expressions and flirt with them. Women's shoes could be in a color that would complement the gown. And their shoes usually looked like this. They had a very low, kind of a chunkier heel to them. Now we're going to shift into men's fashion. The silhouette at this time was a rectangular silhouette, and they generally wore a matching coat and vest with contrasting trousers. So you can see here, they've got a vest, they've got a coat, and their trousers are different color. Typically, it was darker than the upper body, but not always. Men also wore accessories. They had a wingtip collar right here. They had a vest. They had a bow tie. They used gloves. They had black shoes that had a flexible sole for dancing. This was the more formal of the attire for men. So you can see here, this man even has tails on his jacket. We're going to go back here. I want to really, really, let's see. Do they have the wingtip? The wingtip isn't really showing. Dang it. So this is the wingtip. So the reason why it's called a wingtip is because it looks like wings. Some movies that can represent 1890s, and I highly recommend that if you've got some free time to take a little bit to watch them. So we've got Hello Dolly, Far and Away, The Great Mouse Detective, and Newsies. These are all really great movies that really represent this era in dress, and if you watch these movies, I feel like you have a much better understanding of the fashion of this time.